But I still feel like I'm doing the right thing. And that's the most important thing. Yeah, and I think when I get up there that day, hopefully I'm in.
All right, friends, we're going to talk today about an interview that Caitlyn Jenner gave to one of the Fox News representatives a couple months ago that I thought will serve as a baseline for our discussion today. And I will also share some biblical perspective also as we go through that. Please stay tuned. All right, for those of you who don't know, the original name for Caitlyn was Bruce Jenner, and was born on October 28th, 1948 in Mount Kisco, New York. He was one of the most beloved athletes in the 70s in 1976 in the Summer Olympic in Montreal. Jenner won a gold medalist and broke a world record scoring 868,634 points in a decathlon. Jenner has appeared with his family on the popular reality show Keeping Up with the Kardashians. He is a father of several children. In June of 2016, with an interview with Diane Sayer, Bruce Jenner revealed that he is a transgender and identifies as female, and announced on Twitter that she is a woman, now known as Caitlyn Jenner. So in 2015, Jenner had appeared on a cover of the Vanity Fair named Woman of the Year. In a recent interview with a Fox News representative, Caitlyn Jenner had made some remarkable statement about her decision and her perception of God or her idea of heaven. And I thought this was very telling, and what I'm gonna do in this video is play portion of that interview and also look at what the Bible says and also share a little bit of biblical perspective as well. So let's get to that interview now.
Tissue. I snuck around. I wasn't honest with myself. A lot of times not honest with other people. And that all changed when I finally had my final conversation with God. Discussed with all my children, but the last thing I had to do was sit down with my pastor. Because if anybody has any issues in their life that they're struggling, and everybody does, everybody's got stuff they have to deal with. And if they have any faith in their soul whatsoever, they sit there and they go, God, why'd you do this? Why is this issue for me of identity in my head 24 hours a day, every day, 365 days out of the year? You can't take two aspirin, get plenty of sleep, wake up the next morning, and you're fine. It's just always there. It's who you are. But why?
All right, so with that being said, I want to ask a question. What is morally and spiritually wrong with me? And that's a big question that many people wrestle with. They want to know that seems to be something wrong with me, my desires, my flesh, you know, my mind. I seems to want to do things and feel like I should behave certain way. Well, here is what the Bible says. In Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So there is a problem with the human race. What is wrong with us is a sin problem. We are in a fallen condition, and our heart naturally is not bent toward good, but rather it is inclined toward evil. In Romans 3, 10 and 12, the Bible says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth, and there is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They all together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. So the fact of the matter is, it's not whether or not you are homosexual or not, whether you are a thief or not, whether you are a liar or not. When it comes to the law of God, we are all in trouble, all right? And that includes the homosexuals as well, or the transgender person as well, the thief and the liar and the drug dealer as well. So in the eyes of God, we are all in trouble, okay? So, and the thing is, none of us is good enough to stand before God. So we have a problem. It is a sin-sick problem that we have in the human soul, and there has that issue has to be addressed. But here is the thing though, do I blame God for all the things that is wrong with me, my desires, because I was born with a fallen nature? Do I put the blame on God for that? Now, first of all, it's good to know that the reason we are in a condition we are as human beings is because of the fall of men, which took place in the Garden of Eden. We have inherited a fallen nature. But also there is another aspect to that, right? It's not only the nature is fallen, but we have also nurtured, we have also cultivated our evil tendencies over time as well. This could happen through influence. This could happen through our own decisions. This could happen through bad choices that we've made. We can make matters worse based on the decisions that we make and how we allow our mind to be indoctrinated with evil tendencies. And that makes matters worse. So in James chapter 1, 13 and 15, this is what it says. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then, when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. Now, this is what we see based on scripture. So there is a fallen desire that we have, and we cannot tempt God. We can't blame God for it. And secondly, what it says is that this desire, it entices us, right? We are trapped in our own fallen carnal heart, and that entrapment eventually is what gives birth to sin, which is the breaking of God's law. And we are told sin, when it is finished, it brings forth death. Now, let's listen to part two of our video.
It's always there. It's who you are. But why? And so this question was always in my heart. And sitting, I sat down with my pastor. And you know what? I thought, is there a reason for this? Am I doing the right thing? Do I need to come out and make a difference in probably the most marginalized community in the world? After long thought, I said, you know what? At this point in my life, my kids are raised, everybody's fine. Maybe it's time I take care of myself. Because when that day comes and you go up to the pearly gates and you're walking up the stairs and you're seeing God in front of you and you just ask that question, did I do a good job?
Now, hear me ask question number two now. Can I do enough good to go to heaven? Again, this is a very popular way of thinking. In most false religion, this is the view that you will hear. You can almost balance your good versus your bad. Even in some Christians' mind as well. They think, some of us as Christians think we can do enough good to make it to the kingdom of God, right? But here is the thing though. This is what the Bible says in Romans 3:20. The Bible says, therefore, by the deed of the law shall no flesh be justified in the sight of God. Right? For by the law is the knowledge of sin. So there is no good enough work we can perform by keeping the law of God. Right? So no matter how many goods we do, it's just not good enough. And we are told the things that we refer to as goodness, God only looks at that as sin because it is not ordained by God. When he goes to Jeremiah 13 verse 23, can the Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard his spots? May ye also do good that are accustomed to do evil. So God says, listen, we may think we're doing good, but God says your goodness really is coming from a place of that is laced with evil motive. God said you can't do good, and he tells you why you can't do good. It is because you are not able to change your own nature. So in John chapter 15 verse 5, Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. So Jesus makes it clear, we are powerless without God. Even if we try to be good in the best way that we know what goodness is, even in our best performance spiritually or mentally or physically, right, in the best deed we can perform, that's good enough for down here. But to enter the kingdom of God, it's not going to work, because it takes more than just good deeds to save mankind. You see, this is when Jesus comes in. So now let's talk a little bit more. Let's move on now to the next part of our video, and then I have a final verse to bring this to a close.
The stairs, and you're seeing God in front of you, and you just ask that question, did I do a good job? Did I do the right thing? And just hope he says, hey, come on in. I did a good job. So that's what my life's been about.
The last question we are going to answer right now, is there any hope for me? All right, can I have the assurance of everlasting life? Can I be sure that I'm going to heaven, right? Well, first of all, you got to acknowledge that there is a problem with your nature. You can't justify that problem. You can't pacify the problem. And to give in to that fallen nature and think that you can do enough good, as if God is going to overlook these problems, we are making a big mistake. What is going to take? It's going to take a change that comes from the heart of God, that it has to be wrought in our heart. It's going to take a change that God alone can accomplish in us, right? Listen to what the Corinthian church, at the church at Corinth, listen to what the Apostle Paul said about them. He says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetousness, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Wow, this is very strong. In other words, he names a number of sins that in today's world, we will give them a green pass and say, you know, it is what it is. You know, people make their decisions and their choices. We got to respect them for who they are. And I agree with that. But one fact remains, you will not get into God's kingdom with these sins unrepented. What has to happen? There have to be a change. There must be repentance. There must be a renouncing of these sins. Christ must give us the victory over these things. Here is the thing. Look what it says in verse 11 about the Corinthian church, right? The church at Corinth, which is really encouraging. And if you ever wonder if there is any hope, friends, there is hope. There's a lot of hope given in scripture. Now listen to this one. And such were some of you. And I say amen to that, right? Amen. In other words, the church at Corinth had all these type of sinners in it, right? It had the homosexuals, it had the fornicators, it had the idolaters, the thieves, the drunkards, right? The revilers, all of them were there, part of that church. But how did they become so different? Well, I'll tell you what, it was the power of the gospel. You see, Paul says, these were some of you. Such were some of you. In other words, you don't have to remain. I don't have to remain in my fallen. I don't have to keep on practicing sin, and then justify it, so that with good deeds, thinking I'm going to heaven. I don't have to be in bondage to sin. I no longer have to fool myself into the thinking that God cannot help me, or it's just who I am, or I was born this way, or I can't help myself. These thinking are not in accordance with scripture, because Jesus came into the world to save sinners, we are told in the Bible. So regardless of who a person is, by the grace of God, they can overcome. If they want to overcome, if they want to put faith in Jesus, nothing is impossible for them. So, coming to the end of our study here, listen to this. but you are washed, you were washed, and you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. So Paul says, listen, you got to be washed, you got to be sanctified, you got to be justified in the name of Jesus. And this comes by the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is why in Romans 1:16 we are told, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believe. In John 3:16 we are told that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Verse 17 says, for God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And in 2 Corinthians 5:17, the Bible says, for if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. For all things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. In verse 21 of the same chapter, we are told, for God hath made Christ to be sin for us, in him who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So the promises that we are given in the scripture, regardless of who we are and what we have been through, or the decision that we've made, negative ones, regardless of the fact that we have a fallen nature, despite the fact that we have made bad decisions and we are in a bad condition spiritually, the blood of Jesus can cleanse us from all sins. But we must repent, believe, confess, and be born again. This is the truth for you, my dear friends. If you've enjoyed this video, give me a thumbs up, like and subscribe to this channel, and share the content with somebody else as well.